best gimbal in the market, the ultimate content creation machine, the world's most advanced AI tracking, built-in selfie stick for insane creative angles.
Bullshit! All of it! This thing, whatever you want to call it, this is an insult. This is something that should have never been released. And it pisses me off when companies try and do rip people off. Because money doesn't grow on trees, and if I don't like to waste it, I don't expect you will. Look, I could spend all day trying to get 10 or 20 shots, throw in a nice location, a model or two, a good editing, and decent music, and it would look really nice. And you may turn around and think, wow, I really need to buy this because it's gonna be a game changer for me. And I am genuinely losing my faith with all these reviewers on YouTube that recommend this gimbal because, in all fairness, if you have a tiny bit of professional integrity, you cannot be recommending this, especially when there are so many options for similar or even cheaper price. The first thing that I always do when I get a new gimbal is to do an up and down test. And this is nothing scientific. I just want to know whether there is any restrictions or movement. And this gimbal's tilt range is so limited that it's pretty much impossible to do any up and down test. Well, you can see here for yourself. I mean, the moment I go, even if it's like 30 degrees, this gimbal already cannot handle it. It's so bad. Look, with the OM6, you have to go sideways and do it. The problem with this gimbal is that, yes, you can go sideways, but the moment you go a little bit further down, it spins around and it goes into low mode. It's insane. What this means is that you have to literally knee down and try to be like horizontal with your arm and the phone and the gimbal in order to do this racing shot or down up shot. And it's really difficult because this is not a natural movement for our wrist, and you are never gonna get a really nice up and down shot. You are gonna get something that looks weird. It's nuts. This is not how a gimbal is supposed to behave. And only on this test, I would literally send the gimbal back because it's so bad. One of the main reasons people buy a gimbal is to do vlogging with it. It's a mix of normal filming with vlogging, but vlogging is a very important aspect of getting yourself a gimbal. And this gimbal has a lot of limitations, whether you do it vertically or horizontally, and whether you use the front selfie lens or the rear lenses. I always recommend people to vlog with the rear lenses for the simple fact that you don't get distracted with the LCD. Let's say that we go vlogging vertically, okay? So normally you want the camera to be parallel to the ground, okay, flat, but the moment you reach out because you want to have a wider field of view, the phone goes out of whack because the tilting range is so bad, you know? So it's really impossible to have a straight shot. And the same applies if you go horizontal. You outreach to get a wider field of view, and the tilting range is so bad that you cannot really vlog normally, and you're gonna be fighting the gimbal. And the same applies if you vlog with the rear lenses. The tilting range is so bad. Normally, this would be how you want to vlog, okay? So the phone is flat, and I would be getting, you know, a normal shot. Now, let's say that I want to reach out because I want a wider field of view, and you can see here that the moment I reach out, the tilting range goes out of whack. And worse is that if I now, let's say that I vlog vertically with the rear lenses because it's the best thing that I want to do, if you're on ultra wide mode, you're gonna see the gimbal itself. Yes, you could use the selfie stick and you got a hinge there and you can angle it this way, but the gimbal starts to move really weird. If let's say that you move around, you see this bracket that gets into the lens. It's a freaking joke. And if you try to do any creative shots where you want to go from the ground going up, first, this is not a moving hinge, this is fixed. So it might be okay at this height. And this is another thing. Instead of resetting while the lenses are facing your way, it goes back to the default screen, and then you have to go back to three screens and then reset the whole thing. It's just backwards, the design of this whole thing. And as I was saying, it might be okay in this position, but the moment you go down, because it's static, the gimbal goes like, you are basically always in follow mode. It doesn't matter what mode you choose, you are always gonna be in follow mode because the tilting range is so bad. You got yourself a three-axis gimbal, so you want all three axes to be working. And to do that, you need to hold the gimbal in an angle so that all three motors are compensating for any movement. Not like this, this is a two-axis gimbal. So the moment you go a little bit like in an angle, like 30 degrees, the phone cannot be straight. And if what I'm saying is making sense and you feel it's worth sharing, hit the like button so that the algorithm can push this video to as many people as possible and warn them about buying this piece of garbage. Even better, subscribe to the channel so that we can keep on doing videos like this one, what we call our companies, for the dodgy equipment they put out in the market. You can change the gimbal modes on the actual gimbal itself. It's a bit of an innovative design, and theoretically you glide the finger or slide the finger at the top and it will change the modes. Now, I have found it to be very unreliable and temperamental, and I find myself doing it 3, 4, 5 times and I still don't get it, and I have to then swipe with the other hand. And I just so wish that they would just give you a button that you press and it's very reliable. So, in that regard, I think it's a bit of a design flaw. The handle grip is too small. If you have medium or big hands, you're gonna struggle to hold this gimbal comfortably. And yes, you do get this built-in feet or rubber feet, whatever you wanna call it, but it's really badly implemented because sometimes halfway through a shot, depending on the movement that you do, it slides in and you have to then reposition your hand and the shot gets thrown out. So I never use it, I pack it all in and I hold the gimbal from the base. Now, the problem is that because it's so small, I have to cover the whole base with my hand, and it makes it really difficult to use the double tap or reset button. And I then have to, halfway through a take, reposition my hand so that I can get access to it, and potentially it ruins that take. So that's another design flaw that I think this gimbal has. And okay, yes, you could pack this, you know, and put it away in your pocket, for instance, okay? But when was the last time you casually took a gimbal out on a day out with friends or with the family to, I don't know, film the dog or the kids? When was the last time? Please let me know in the comments below, because I would love to hear what you guys think about this. All I'm trying to say here is that please don't fall for marketing nonsense and pointless features that only make sense on paper, but they are far from ideal in real life. Now, is the app any good? Well, of course it's good. It's the only thing is good about this gimbal, or at least half decent. Because, you know, you can do auto or manual, you have all the adjustments that you need. And in that regard, it's really well implemented. It opens really quick, so that's something that is really good about this gimbal. It takes no time. The moment you fire up the app, it links up to the gimbal and off you go. You are ready to rumble. So that is good. Now, the downside is that you have no 10-bit recording, no HDR, and no flat color spaces. So you are limited to 8-bit, take it or leave it. So if that works for you, then great. But if you're looking for a bit more functionality, you're gonna have to use a third-party app. The zooming is okay, but even if you set it too slow, it's really and truly only for reframing. It's not something that you can zoom through a shot because it's just not able to do it. Now, one thing that the app gives you that many gimbal apps don't do is a histogram. So that is really nice because it's gonna mean the difference between having a shot overexposed, underexposed, or correctly exposed. You also get these advanced features like the live mode and hook mode, which I think for most people buying this gimbal are pointless features that they'll never use. But unfortunately, this is how I think this gimbal is designed to be used. It's static on a tripod, on a table, and taking advantage of the AI sensor that will come to this in a minute, or these features that very few people will actually use. Because otherwise, as a gimbal, there are so many better options in the market today that I cannot imagine anybody recommending this gimbal. Why would anybody recommend this gimbal? It's one of those mysteries in life. And yet, you watch YouTube videos and it seems that this is the best gimbal ever invented. I don't know. I'm baffled by this. One thing that is really well implemented is the AI tracking, because in my opinion, they've done a really good job here, because once it locks on you, whether it's on the selfie lens or the rear lens, this thing won't let go and is very reliable. Now, the only downside that I can see is that it keeps everything in the middle of the frame. So whether you're tracking a person or an object, it's always gonna keep it there, and you're gonna have to zoom in post-production and potentially waste 20, 30, 40% of the frame, trying to make sure that you don't have this massive headroom above your head, and you have no way of adjusting this. So that's, to me, a bit of a downer. Now, I think it's the best tracking in the market today, except for the Hohem iSteady M6, which I think it's still miles ahead of this. On the other hand, time lapses is very well implemented, but this is the same with pretty much any other gimbal these days. You know, they give you all the features, they give you all the waypoints that you can set, and it will move really nice and smoothly. The problem with this gimbal, okay, is this fit, okay? I think it's a good idea, but it's very badly implemented because it's very flimsy, and it makes it really difficult to mount a tripod base plate onto the base of the gimbal. And this is gonna limit the stability of the gimbal because you cannot rely on this fit. This is very unstable, and all you need is a breeze and this thing will rock like it's on a dance floor. So in my opinion, unless you are in a situation where there is not a single breeze or air, this gimbal is not gonna give you a time lapse that you can use because it's gonna move way too much. So that's in a nutshell AI tracking and time lapses. Personally, I think this gimbal promises a lot, but delivers very little. So who is this gimbal for then? Well, in my opinion, this gimbal is for nobody. I cannot recommend to a single person this gimbal because the vertical filming is badly implemented, horizontal filming is badly implemented, the functionality is all over the place. This gimmicky base plate tripod legs is flimsy, it's unstable, you cannot attach a base plate comfortably to it. I mean, there are so many wrong things about this gimbal that I don't know what... Even... I cannot believe they call this a gimbal, for crying out loud. This is an embarrassment, should have never been released. And I genuinely hope that you consider different alternatives that are in a similar or even lower price range that are much better, like the Z-Unit Smooth 5S or the Hohem iSteady M6 or even the Hohem iSteady Mobile Plus at $60 less than this. And if you want to watch my head-to-head comparison between the Smooth 5S and the Hohem M6, I'll leave the video here. I think you're gonna find it really interesting. Now, my next video is gonna be comparing this gimbal to the Hohem M6, both of them with AI tracking. And I'll leave the video up here, and hopefully you'll find them really interesting. Click on any of them and I'll see you there.